Hello, everyone. We are so glad that you're tuning in. You know, we haven't been able to meet in our building for right around 4 weeks, but pretty soon we'll be back in our building. But until then, this is what we're going to do. We're going to continue having watch parties and expanding this message into homes. You know, the enemy, I believe, really believed that he thought, well, he's going to shut down the church. But in reality, we're reaching more people than we've ever reached. You know, last weekend, we reached right around 24,000 people that tuned in. And we're talking about 24,000 views. We don't even know actually how many people were in those rooms as they were watching. Maybe we reached last week 50, 60, 70,000 people that heard the good news of Jesus Christ. What we're gonna do is we're gonna face our difficult times, but we're also gonna overcome in our difficult times. And today what I wanna do is talk to you about how to get through difficult times. There's a story in the Bible about a man named Jairus that ran into the most difficult time of his life. This is what I've learned about difficult times. We will all go through them. There's no one that won't face difficult times. Our approach and our mindset and our perspective is gonna determine whether we're gonna succeed or end up in defeat. Really, God is saying this. When we're going through difficult times, it's not meant to break us. It's meant to make us. We're supposed to grow. We're supposed to come out of it with a testimony after the test. We're supposed to come out of it with greater blessing and also spiritual growth. So let's go ahead and dive into this story about a man named Jairus. And in Mark chapter 5, verse 21, it says, Jesus got into the boat again and went back to the other side of the lake where a large crowd gathered around him on the shore. Then a leader of a local synagogue, whose name was Jairus, arrived. When he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet, pleading fervently with him. My little daughter is dying, he said. Please come and lay your hands on her so she can live. Now, what I want to do is before I dive into this story even deeper, I wanna cover three things we need to know about Jesus to help us get through difficult times. And even in these first two scriptures, we're gonna see some things about Jesus. Number one, we need to know that he is there in our difficult times. The scripture starts off that Jesus got in the boat again. What does that mean? Is that he last time he got in that boat, he crossed over, he ran into a storm. And in that storm, his disciples were really afraid. He had to rebuke them because they forgot that he was in the boat with them. He got to the other side and there was a man that was demon possessed. He was a hopeless case. Everybody gave up on him. He was actually living in a cemetery. And while he was living in that cemetery, they used to put chains on him and he would break them. He was the most hopeless case. After he had an encounter with Jesus, Jesus set that man free. But after he set him free, this is what happened. The whole village, the whole region told Jesus, we don't want you here. So he ran into rejection. Getting there, he ran into a storm. But that did not discourage him from getting into that boat again. Why would Jesus get into that boat again? He was going to the other side to reach more hurting people. He was not gonna be discouraged. There's a time in our lives that if we have a mission to reach people, this is what we need to do. Do it again. That means don't let the storms, don't let the difficulties stop you from moving forward. It didn't stop Jesus. So Jesus got in the boat again to get to this man named Jairus. But not only him, every other person that was hurting, broken, or maybe even hopeless at that time. So now, Jesus is there in our difficult times. He's available to Jairus. Jesus didn't let anything stop him. See, we don't need to be afraid. I want you to get this. God is actually with us. It's something we need to be aware of. He's really there. In Deuteronomy 31:8, it says this, the Lord will lead you. He himself is with you. He will not fail you or leave you. Don't worry, don't be afraid. How comforting it is to know that even while we're going through a difficult time, it might be a marriage problem, it might be bad news that you've gotten from your employer, it could be bad news that you got from the doctor saying you're sick and there's nothing we can do to help you. Maybe someone left you. The reality is those things do happen, but we need to be aware of this. God is actually with us. And this is what he's saying. Don't fear, don't worry. Me and you got this. Now, Jesus does not run away from us when we have difficulties. A matter of fact, he is attracted to our difficulties. When we're going through a tough time, he runs to us, not runs away from us. Others might run away from us, but God runs to us. He draws close to us. Our problems are an attraction to him. In the Bible, we see one day the disciples began to cross over by themselves. Jesus was praying, and they get in the boat and they run into another storm. And while they run into the storm, right around 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus is aware that they're in a storm. You know what he does? He walks. This is a story about Jesus walking on water. Why was Jesus walking on water? He wasn't surfing. He was searching for his disciples because they were in a storm. They were full of fear. They were going through a difficult time. And instead of staying on the shoreline, he began to walk on water towards their storm. This is what God does. Look at this other scripture in Psalms 34:18. It says, "The Lord is close to those who have suffered disappointment." Jesus draws in close to us in our difficult times. Jesus draws in close to us in our difficult times. Read the scripture again. The Lord is close to those who have suffered disappointment. He saves those who are discouraged. If right now you're suffering disappointment, you're going through a difficult time, it did not turn out the way you thought it was going to turn out. Or maybe you thought by this time in your life, you'd be farther along than you are. It's not too late. God is saying he draws close to those who have suffered disappointment and he saves those who are discouraged. You might be discouraged right now, but the purpose of this message is for us to realize, hey, I'm going through a difficult time, but let me get my perspective right. God will save me. God is here. He is close to me. God himself is in the storm with me. God himself is in the fire with me. I am not alone. If we're going to get through this, we need to know that Jesus is with us. The second thing we need to know is that he desires to help us in our difficult times. As soon as Jairus asked for help, you know what Jesus did? He helped them. Let's look at this scripture again. It says, "Then the leader of the local synagogue, whose name was Jairus, arrived. When he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet, pleaded fervently with him. 'My little daughter is dying,' he said. 'Please come and lay your hands on her. Heal her so she can live.'" And verse 24 says this, "Jesus went with him, and all the people followed, crowding around him." Look, think about this. Jesus could have made a big excuse. He said, could you see there's a large crowd around me and you want me to leave this crowd and follow you home and lay hands on your daughter? I don't think so. But this is exactly what happened. As soon as he asked for help, Jesus immediately responded. He didn't have to beg him. Jesus was there to help him. He traveled again. He got in that boat again and he came to that shoreline to help Jairus. God is here to help you. Knowing that we have God's help is a big comfort in difficult times. We do have God's help. He's willing to help us. He wants to help us. Why not get the help if it's there? See, we can bring our most difficult problems to God. He isn't intimidated. It might be difficult or impossible for us, but not for God. Jairus brought a dying daughter to Jesus. And I really think this is probably what happened. He went to the doctors. and they treated his daughter. And then they finally said something like this: I'm sorry, we've done everything that we could. We need to send your daughter home. She's going to die. And Jairus at that point was desperate. His friends couldn't help him. The doctors couldn't help him. There was nobody that could help him. He had an impossible situation. And he started thinking, I've heard and I've saw Jesus do miracles. And he started thinking, this is not too difficult for him. It might be too difficult for me. Listen to this. With God, all things are possible. In Matthew 19:26, it says this: But Jesus looked at them and said, with people, as far as it depends on them, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Think about that. With man, it looks like it's impossible if it depends on them. But with God, all things are possible. This scripture gives us hope that no matter what we're going through, it's not too difficult for God. It's time to change our perspective and know this, that nothing is too difficult for God. He is with you and he is able. We can get through this difficult time. And the other thing that we need to know is that he wants to help us in these difficult times. And I said that before, but I want you to know that. So I'm going to go through this one more time. Number one, know that he is there in our difficult times. Number two, know that he desires to help us in difficult times. And number three, know that nothing is too difficult for him. Now I'm going to give you four keys to getting through difficult times that we could find in this portion of scripture. So now we see Jairus, he has a difficult situation. This might be the most difficult situation he's ever been in his life. Now, difficult situations don't last forever. They are usually a moment. You know, we go through recessions in our economy, but they don't last forever. They're temporary. But when you're going through them, they're difficult. They're heartbreaking. It looks like it's hopeless. But Jairus got through this. And at the end of this story, he receives a miracle. There's some keys in this portion of scripture that will help us get through our difficult times. Key number one, ask for help. Jairus, ask for help. We were never meant to go through difficult times alone. Right now, if you're going through difficult times, do not isolate yourself. Ask for some help. Help is available. I'll say this, let go of the pride. It's okay to say, I need some help right now. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm overwhelmed. I am hurting. It's okay to acknowledge our problems. It's okay to feel like you don't have all the answers. It's okay to let our guard down. Who cares what people think? Could it be that we need help and we're more concerned about the crowd than just getting the help? I don't have to have all my stuff together. But I know that's why I need God. Because I don't have all my stuff together. Ask for help. It might be a brother or sister in the Lord that could help you, that Jesus would use to help you. It's okay. If you're hungry, ask for food. If you need advice, it's okay. You need prayer. It's good. Ask for help. And you're going to find out that everyone needs help. So Jairus, this is what he does. Then the leader of the local synagogue, he was a leader. And usually people would come to him for help. And I'm sure that he would give them really great counsel. But this was a problem that he didn't have an answer for. And he knew no one that could actually help him but Jesus Christ. So the leader of the local synagogue, whose name was Jairus, arrived. When he saw Jesus, look what he did. When he saw Jesus, he saw an opportunity. There were crowds, large crowds around Jesus. And I don't think Jairus was the only one going through a difficult time. There were others that were going through a difficult time. But the difference between Jairus and the rest of the crowd is that Jairus did something. Look what he did. When he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet, pleading fervently with him. "My little daughter is dying," he said. "Please come and lay your hands on her. Heal her so she can live." So what did Jairus do? He when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. You know what he did? He was willing to stand out of the crowd and say, "I have a major difficulty. I have a major problem. Will you come? Will you help me?" This is good news. And you know what happened after Jairus asked for help? Jesus just said, "Yes, that's why I'm here. I'm not here to hang out. I'm not here because of the weather. I'm not here to sightsee. I am here to help those that realize they need help and are willing to place their faith in me and ask for help." See, if we ask for help, look at this, he will help us. Wow. If we ask for help, Jesus will help us. You know, we're living in a society where we want to be self-made. We want to be independent. We want to act like I got my stuff together, and on social media, we'll post our best pictures. We'll just talk about our highlights. But the reality is we're going through difficult times. And when we put our head on that pillow, we're lonely. We're depressed. We feel like we're stuck. And we're trying to cope with all these problems, with the coronavirus, having fears, struggling all on our own. And when was the last time that you just prayed and admitted, "God, this is my circumstance"? Now, when Jairus told Jesus about his daughter dying, when we tell our problems to God, God is not intimidated, or he's not surprised, or it's not something he doesn't know about. Of course he knows. The Bible says that he even knows what you need before you ever ask. God is really concerned about you. Matter of fact, there's no one that loves you more than him. There's no one more concerned than him. Why not ask for help? There's a scripture in the Bible that says he even has the hairs on your head numbered. Think about that. Who loves you that much? You're not alone. Jesus is there right now, himself right now with you to help you through every single circumstance. Wow, I love that. So he asked for help. Now, if we ask for help, he will help us. In John 14, 13, it says this: "Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do." What Jesus said this. "Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." Look at this in verse 20, John 14, 14. It says, "If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it." In this portion of scripture, he says the same statement twice. Look what he says. "Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it." In verse 20, in verse 13. Verse 14, "If you ask anything in my name, I will" what? "Do it." God is saying, if you ask, I will do it. Now, the reason Jairus got help is because he asked. See, now let's go the opposite. If we don't ask for help, we won't get help. Think about that. If we don't ask for help, the help's there, but we're not going to get it. And I wonder what area you're trying to overcome or challenge you're facing or difficulty, and you have not asked for help. Do you know there's others that have gone through what you're going through and they know how to get through it? There's others that know how to do marriage the right way, and if you'd just be willing to ask, you could get some help. There's others that know business, the business you're in, and they know how to deal with the challenges and they've been successful. They can do it. There are others that know how to walk in joy and peace and emotionally be strong, and they could help you. And I want, most of all, there's a God that loves you and he knows you, and he's saying, "Look, I can fix it all. There's nothing intimidating to me. I can help you. I'm the one that created the heavens and the earth. My wisdom is available to you. My provision is available to you. Everything I have is yours." Why aren't you asking? Because if you don't ask, you're not going to receive. In James 4:2, it says this: "You desire and do not have." so you murder. You covet and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. This scripture is talking about a person that doesn't have, and instead of asking God, he's just jealous. He becomes a hater, murderer, hater. Hates people because they're succeeding. Hates people because they're happy. Starts being jealous. Oh my, I wish I could be. You don't have to wish you could be anybody, because the same God that's helping them is going to help you. He loves you, but how are you going to get the help? Ask for help. Ask for healing. Ask for freedom. Ask for joy. Ask for a new beginning. Ask for eternal life. If you ask, you will have it. Key number two, have faith. Jairus had faith in Jesus, not faith in his problem. Now, when you have faith in your problem, you know what that means? Is you believe your problem's bigger than your ability and also God. When you have faith in your problem, I call it this. I call it fear, anxiety, and worry. When you really believe that your problem is unsolvable, when you really believe that your problem is bigger than you and you don't see a way out, you know what it causes? Fear, anxiety, and worry. See, faith is getting a mental picture of victory, healing, freedom, provision, growth, salvation, promotion, peace, joy, heaven, restoration, and believing it's going to happen. So it's getting a vision and believing it's going to happen. See, we're going through difficult times, but this would be the problem. You don't see yourself getting through it. You actually see yourself being defeated by it. It's overwhelming you. It's taking over your emotions. And it seems like your mind has been taken over by your problem. Your mind has been, I'll say it again. Your mind has been taken over by your problem instead of your solution. Man, that's no way to live. See, we can live in fear and have this horrible image about our future and be depressed and hopeless and full of anxiety, stress, and worry. Or we could have a vision. I'm going to get through this. I see myself getting to the other side. I'm going to come out of this with a great testimony. By the time this trial, by the time the coronavirus is said and is gone, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to be a better person. I'm going to be stronger. I'm going to have a better family. I'm going to look for the good in this. You know, that's what I'm trying to do, is look for the good in it. You know, this week we had our food pantry at our downtown campus, which is really the only part of our church that's really open, doing ministry every single day. We're feeding still thousands of people that are hungry. And we go out there and we buy the food and we bring it in, and people are lined up around the building trying to get food. And this is what happened this week. An arsonist came, and out of all the rooms that he could have, you know, put the fire in, was that room with all the food. And I got a call, and when I got that call, it was late at night. We have a fire at the downtown campus. The fire went in that room, burned up all the food, burned that room. They had to put a hole in the roof. And the first thing I thought about was, oh man, we're going to be able to feed. But then I heard the Holy Spirit say, come on, have faith. Have faith. It's all going to work out. And then I started thinking, wow, the devil's angry. You know what's going to come out of this? We're going to feed more people than we've ever fed. We're not stopping. This week, the day after, you know what we did? We opened up, got some more food, and we're doing feeding people. That's what we're going to continue doing. And this is what we're going to have. We're going to have a brand new, this is what I believe in. We're going to have a brand new food pantry. As a matter of fact, we even have a building right now that we're refurbishing, and we're going to have freezers in there. We're not going backwards. See, I'm getting a vision. I'm not getting a vision, oh man, we're going to get shut down. Oh man, the devil's just had, I don't care what the devil's doing, because no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And when it's all said and done, we're going to come out better than we were before we went into trial. Wow. A trial is meant to promote us, not demote us. Be careful that you're not letting fear become your vision. So Jairus has a vision, and he has faith. Now, look what the Bible's definition of faith is. In Hebrews 11:1, it says this. What is faith? It is a confident, look at this. It is the confident assurance that something we want is going to happen. It is a certainty that what we hope for is waiting for us, even though we cannot see it up ahead with our physical eyes. So Jairus, look at that, I want to read again. What is faith? It is a confident assurance that something we want is going to happen. Not something we don't, that's fear. Fear is believing that something we don't want is going to happen. Why live that way? I'm believing that something I want, I'm believing for, is going to happen. All things will work out for good. That's right. Something good is coming in my future. See, if you don't get that mindset, this is going to happen. Nothing good's coming. Because there's a saying, if you can't see it, you ain't going to achieve it. Get your mind out of the gutter. Get your mind out of despair and put it back on God. God's going to work this all out for good. You know, oh, she left me. Well, God can restore that. Or maybe you say, oh, she left me. Well, you know, God is so good, man. My girlfriend left me. What? And you get focused on that. I'm so brokenhearted. This is what maybe God's going to do. God's going to bring somebody else that loves you even more, that won't take advantage of you, that will never walk out on you. Stop focusing on the negative and let's get some faith that God's going to work this out for good. Well, I'm a single, I'm lonely right now. Stop it. Spend your time with God. Use this time to get prepared. Use this time for ministry. Get your mind out of the gutter. Get your mind back on a vision. Look at this. Faith is an assurance that something we want is going to happen. It is a certainty that what we hope for is waiting for us. I'm sure that our downtown campus is going to be better after than it was even before the fire. I'm believing that. I believe I'm going to be better after this difficulty. I'm going to be a wiser leader. I'm going to be more prepared. As a matter of fact, right now, you know what we're doing? We're doing this in a studio. You know what it's doing? It's preparing us to do this kind of ministry throughout the world. We're not just meeting in a building. We're meeting in living rooms all over the world. We're reaching more people. See, I'm not waiting for everything to be fixed. It's already fixed up here. And if I really believe it's fixed up here, and I'm sure and I'm confident it's going to work out, why be depressed? Act like you really believe it, because you do. Come on. That's good. So Jesus commands us not to be afraid. Now, this is what happened. Jairus has a clear mental picture. And the clearer the picture, this is what the more faith you have. His vision is so clear. This is what he thinks. I know my daughter's dying. Fact, I understand that. But I know Jesus can heal her. So he sees himself going to Jesus and he acts on it. Doesn't just talk about it. He acts on it. He has a picture. And I know he has a picture because he describes it very clear. He comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, will you come to my home? I have a little girl that's dying, and lay hands on her so she can be healed and live. So he has a vision of Jesus coming with him, leaving the crowds, and coming to his home, laying hands on his daughter, and she being healed. That's what faith is. It's a vision. And Jesus says, I was just waiting for someone to have a vision. That's what I'm here to do. I was just waiting for someone to have faith. Let's go do this. Isn't that good? And Jesus, now this is what happened. Right after Jesus tells him that, Jairus asked Jesus to come to his house, he got some bad news. In Mark 5:35, while he was still speaking to her, there was a lady with the issue of blood. She got healed, and Jesus was speaking to her. While they were on the way to Jairus' house, messengers arrived from the home of Jairus, the leader of the synagogue. They told him, your daughter is dead. There's no use troubling the teacher now. But Jesus overheard them and said, Jairus, don't be afraid, just have faith. I want you to think about this. So they're on their way. It looks like it's coming to pass. And in the middle of their faith journey, a messenger comes. Be careful that you don't get stuck on a bad report. That's why you need faith. Because in the middle of your vision, there will always be an assignment of the enemy to plant doubt and fear in you. I remember my daughter was sick in the hospital with cancer. Every day I went in there, it was a bad report. Her fever's up. She doesn't look like she's responding really well. We don't know if she's gonna make it. Every day. But before I got that message, I had a vision that my daughter was gonna be healed. And you know what I had to do? I had to resist the fear and have faith. Just have faith. I go, okay. And then I continued speaking. I continued believing that my daughter one day would be healed. And my prayer life and the prayer that I said over my daughter would match up one day with the reports of the doctor. Well, it wasn't much longer that the doctor's report said, we can't find any more cancer in her blood. She's healed 100%. And this last month, she's 20-some years old, and she just had a grandbaby. God is good. There was a victory after the trial and the difficulty. But important, have faith. Believe it. Don't grab on to fear. Hold on to faith. Jesus commanded it. Don't be afraid. Don't do that. Don't be afraid. Just have faith. See, faith is believing even when it looks impossible. Keep on believing even when it looks impossible. A great example of this is in Romans 4:18. It says, even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping, believing that he would become the father of many nations. For God has said to him, that's how many descendants you will have. And Abraham's faith did not weaken. Even though about 100 years of age, he figured his body was good as dead. But I love this. He never stopped believing. That's faith right there. That you keep on believing even after the bad reports. She's dead. Don't bother the teacher. It's gone. Abraham, you're supposed to have a baby and you're 100 years old. Good luck. It's so easy to look at our problems and think there's no way. Well, there might be no way for you, but there's always a way with God. Your faith is not in you. Your faith is not in the economy. Your faith is not in the coronavirus and the doctors. Your faith is in God. And with God now, we can do it. How many believe we can do it? Yes. And key number 3, surround yourself with believers. That means if you're going through a difficult time, don't surround yourself with a whole bunch of naysayers. Surround yourself with people that agree with the vision that you have of overcoming, of getting through this, becoming victorious, being restored, being healed. You know what Jesus did? While he's going to Jairus' house, he starts eliminating people that aren't believers. He starts saying, on this journey, you can't come with me because you're not a believer. Look at what he says in Mark 5:37. Then Jesus stopped the crowd and wouldn't let anyone go with him except Peter, James, and John. So nine of his disciples were excluded for taking this walk, this faith journey. The brother of James, verse 38. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw much commotion and weeping and wailing. He went inside and asked, why all the commotion and weeping? This child isn't dead. She's only asleep. The crowd laughed at him, but he made them all leave. He made them all leave, and he took the girl's father and mother and his 3 disciples into the room where the girl was lying. So Jesus has a vision. He really gets it from Jairus that he's going to lay hands on this little girl that's dying. Matter of fact, she's now dead. He's going to lay hands on her, and she's going to recover. But what he does before he lays hands on her, there's people in the room that are crying, that are wailing, whole bunch of commotion. They're probably saying, Jesus, you should have came earlier. You're too late. You should have known she was going to die. And Jesus says, nope, she's not dead. She's only sleeping. And you guys, get out of this room. And when he said, get out, you know what they started doing? They started laughing. See, there is power. Check this out. There's power in agreement. Get some people. It might be less people in your life. Some of us need to start by faith, just cutting some people out that are holding you back. They're not believers. They're doubters. See, not everybody that's right now in your pity party is actually for you. These people that were wailing and crying, they really weren't for the resurrection of that little girl. They were just fortifying the mess, fortifying the death. Do you know there's some people that when you're going through a tough time, they're rubberneckers. You know what that means? You're in an accident and they're slowing down the car because they want to see all the gory details. They're not there to help you. They're not there to support you. They're there to, I'm gonna say this, put the nail in your coffin. We need to start recognizing that not everybody needs to stay in our life where we're going. If you have a vision to live for God, then live for God and surround yourself with people that are believers. If you have a vision to overcome an addiction, surround yourself with people that want to overcome the addiction. Dude, if you want to be healed, surround yourself with people that believe in your healing. This is what we need to do. If you want to be successful in life, surround yourself with people that believe in your success. Yes. So there is power in agreement. And Jesus knew this. In Matthew 18, 19, it says, again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Look at this. Agreement. He goes, if just two of you agree on anything, it will be done for them. And Jesus already knew, I'm not going to fill that room with a whole bunch of doubt, because I understand this. A room full of doubt, a city full of doubt, this is what it does. It hinders miracles from happening. I need everyone in that room. Mama's going to come in. Dad's going to come in. The three disciples and me and that little dead girl. We're going to go in that room and we're going to agree. And we're going to believe for a miracle. Wow. The power of agreement. And the last key is speak life, not death. It's a key to getting through a difficult time. Speak life, not death. Don't continually talk about the problem. It's time to talk about the solution. We need to stop talking about how I'm feeling. I understand. But let's not just talk. I'm feeling lonely. I'm hurt. I'm disappointed. I'm mad. Let's get rid of that and start speaking life. Speak life, not death. Jesus, when he went in that room, you know what he said? He said something that no one else was willing to say. You got to be willing to speak life even when everyone around you only sees death and is speaking death. You have to be even willing to say things that make you look crazy. When Jesus said this, the girl is not dead. She's just sleeping. You know what they all did? The people that are crying. All of a sudden, see, they're fakers. Next minute, they're laughing. So how could you be crying and the next minute you're laughing? If there really were four Jairus and his wife and that little girl, they would have said, really? Oh, you're going to resurrect her from the dead? Because they all knew that Jairus left the dying little girl to go get Jesus. And some of them probably were saying this, how irresponsible. You're leaving your daughter while she's dying. You should be there at her deathbed. But Jairus refused to have that vision, seeing his daughter die. He went to get Jesus to heal his daughter. So Jesus cleared the room, and then he spoke when no one else was willing to speak. She's not dead. It's not over. It's not over. She is going. She's just sleeping. That's all. To me, it's just sleep. I'm going to resurrect her. So every one of you get out that don't agree with that vision. Don't laugh yourself outside that door, because he who laughs, laughs, laughs best. We're going to find this out. Look at this. So Jesus spoke. And I want you to think about this. Jesus spoke the vision, not the difficulty. You have to be careful that you're just talking about your problem, and you're not speaking the solution. Because how can you have a victorious life if your conversation is full of defeated words? Never going to happen. Jesus spoke to the difficulty, not about it. So he spoke. He says, and this is what he says. Look at it. In Mark 5:41, and this is the last scripture. It says, holding her hand, he said to her, Talitha kaum, which means, little girl, get up. And the girl was 12 years old, who was 12 years old, immediately stood up and walked around. Wow. So Jesus doesn't talk about the problem. She's dead. I don't know. Am I came too late? And he said, no. Let's just speak life. She's only sleeping. And he goes, next thing he says, words. I think if the right words were not in that room, we would never see the right outcome. Maybe right now in your difficult time, you need to stop talking about all the problems and the difficulty. Maybe we're becoming experts on the coronavirus and we're not experts on healing. Maybe we're experts on all the laws that they're putting into place, and I love it, to protect us. That's good. But be careful that you don't believe more in the laws to protect you than your God to protect you. Let's get our conversation back in the right place. Let's have our words full of faith, full of restoration. Yes, the best days of my life are ahead of me. I'm going to serve God. We're going to overcome. I'm going to come out of this blessed and strong. It's going to happen. I believe I'm healed in the name of Jesus. I'm free. I'm going to live for God. What the devil meant for harm, God's going to turn around for good. All things will work together for good for those who love God and called according to his purpose. This is going to work out. Speak life. And the scripture says he told her, get up. And you know what happened? She got up immediately. Wow. Speak the right words. Now, Jesus is still speaking. Get up. And right now he's speaking to some of you right now. He's saying, get up out of your addiction. Get up out of your depression. Get up and be healed. Get up and serve God. Get up and have your broken heart mended. Get up and overcome. Get up and succeed. This message, just like it got to this little girl in her specific room, she was 12 years old. She couldn't help herself, but the one that was speaking to her could help her. And right now, Jesus is coming into your living room, into your car, into your bedroom, and you're saying, Pastor, I'm going through a difficult time. I've been overwhelmed. I'm hurting. I'm broken. And you know what Jesus is saying right now? Get up. That's why I'm here. Get up. This is not a time to stay dead. This is a time to rise up and have the life that you've been looking for and searching for your whole life. Here. It's here. This moment can change your life forever. So what are we going to do? We've learned this, that there's some keys. Number one, ask for help. Ask for Jesus to save you. Ask for Jesus to help you. He's willing. Number two, have faith. Get a vision from God's word. Stand on his promises. You're going to get through this. Don't get a vision of fear, but get a vision of faith. You can't have both. Look at your future through God's eyes. God has a plan for good and not evil, hope in the future. Number three, surround yourself with believers. Even if it's just two people, if two people agree. Maybe right now you've been isolated, and we've all been isolated because God's trying to separate us from people that have just been a bad influence over us. And God says, no, let's get rid of those people in your life. Let me speak to you. And maybe you only have a few people around you, but those people believe in you and they love you. And the last thing, speak life and not death. So today's your day. Jesus is saying, speak. This is what he's saying. Get up. And you know what you need to do is receive it. Today is a day of your salvation. If you're saying, Pastor, that's me. I want a new start. I want a new beginning. I feel like I'm that dead girl, or I feel like I'm Jairus. I'm dealing with a hopeless situation. And I feel like I'm overwhelmed and overcome. Let's pray right now. If you call on Jesus, open your mouth. Say, Jesus, I want to be saved today. I want a new start today. I want a new beginning. I want you to pray with me. You're saying, Pastor, I need to come back to God. Just like Jairus fell at Jesus' feet, it's time for me to fall at Jesus' feet today and ask forgiveness for my sins. I need a new start. And just admit, I can't do it on my own. I'm going to ask you this question. If today were your last day on earth, do you know where you spend eternity? You say, Pastor, I don't know. Why stay that way? Right now, are you dealing with something you can't overcome? You have an addiction that you can't overcome, or an emotional state that you're in you can't overcome? I get it. We've all been there. But there's help, and it's here right now. And there's a God that loves you, and he wants to be your friend. He wants to help you. Let's pray together. Let's receive Jesus. Let's come back to Jesus, and let's give Jesus all of our problems. Everyone that's listening, let's pray. There's power in this prayer. Jairus prayed, and God answered. Jesus answered. You're going to pray, and Jesus is going to answer. Pray with me. Say, Jesus, I ask you now to forgive me of all my sins. I need your help. I can't do this on my own. I'm lonely. I'm brokenhearted. I'm depressed. I feel overwhelmed. But I thank you, after I've heard this message, that you love me, that you're here for me, and you're close to me, especially in this time. Come into my heart. Save me. Forgive me. Today, I open my heart's door and ask you to come in. I receive the free gift of eternal life and help. Heal me, restore me, and make me new. Amen. If you said that prayer and you meant it, I got good news for you. You're saved. You have eternal life. And all the help that you need is right there with you. I love you, and most of all, Jesus loves you. And there's nothing that will stop him from having a relationship with you. And this is the truth. He'll never leave you. People walk out on you, but he never will. God bless you, love you, and see you after this service, at the after party, and we'll turn in your prayer requests because we want to pray with you. God bless you. We love you.